second half is something I've maybe never heard before. It may be a world premiere, except for last Saturday when I played on the South Side. And there are actually three Etudes studies that I think are often pretty melodious by a French composer. We're into the next century, probably. He was born in 1782, which makes him an exact contemporary of Paganini, and that's between Beethoven and Schubert at the very beginning of the Romantic period. So these, his name is Jacques-Fereol probably Mazas, but we just call him Mazas. They're violin etudes, so I'm borrowing from the violin repertoire. And as I say, I haven't heard of anyone performing them before. But so they're interspersed in books of trill studies and 16th notes and warms and sustained bows and what have you. So I picked three, and the first one is simply called, they don't have actual titles, this is, simply has a tempo marking of Andante Grazioso, kind of moderately and gracefully.
Thank you.
using our modern bow, and I've tuned up to modern pitch, the A that we all know and love. With the Baroque, when I said Baroque pitch or low pitch, I meant that there, I should have said that what they call A sounds to our ear like A flat. So their pitch was a half step lower than ours today. So the modern bow is longer, I can even show you, a little heavier, and especially at the tip. If I measure from the length of the hair, that's a good inch and a half maybe, the hair is longer. You can see the difference of the shape of the point of the tip. And the heavier head means that you can get an even sound from one end of the bow to the other. That's what they strive for.
When was that developed then?
Around 1800. So someone asked the other day, these etudes, would they have been played at low pitch also? Because he was born in 1782. But actually, he probably wrote these into the 19th century, and the pitch had already gone up to 421 during the classical period. So it was 415 for Baroque, 421 for classical, and it kept coming up to our modern pitch of 440. So I think these would have been played more towards our modern pitch. My viola was made 5 years after our composer was made, 1787. It's English. Benjamin Banks from Salisbury, England. And as violas go, it's not large. It's not a great deal larger than my violin. The body, we measured the body of the instrument. My violin is typical, it's 14 and a half inches here. My viola is 15 and a quarter, so that quite small violas can go up to 17 inches. I don't think that hampers its sound. And someone told me that English violas from that time that were small were perhaps made for the opera. Operas are so often longer performances. So it's a little bit out for that time.
How did you acquire this viola?
Well, it was while I was playing in the symphony, and I forget if it was 50 or 20 years ago, I went with a girlfriend who was a lawyer for the teachers union, and she was looking for a good amateur violin. She found one, which was made by the father of my violin, while we were at the dealer in Chicago at Carl Becker's, a fine dealer, and he was a fine maker. I saw the little viola, and I thought, oh, it's so beautiful. I tried it, and I bought it.
Okay.
So it's really since I've retired that I'm able to enjoy it, and some other things, too. So the second one is called number 31. It's Adagio non troppo, moving slowly but not too slow. I have to keep checking the pitch because since I had it at low pitch before. It takes a while to settle in, and it wants to revert back to the pitch it was at.
Thank you.
but part of his family is here, Patty, and his father, Alvin. Thanks to Tom. And last one is something called Andante.